Behind home plate, we bringing it to them all day. All day. You know what's up? Welcome to Birdland. Birdland. Win or lose, we bringing it to you always. Always. You know what's up? Welcome to Birdland. Orange or black, we rebuild the pack. No matter where we at, you know we coming back. Section 336, we on this, so tune in. Tune in. You know what's up? Welcome to Birdland. Yeah. Welcome to Birdland. You know what's up, son. Welcome to Birdland. Birdland.
Now, here come the boys from Section 336.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Baltimore sports fans of all ages, welcome to Section 336, Next Generation Baltimore Sports Talk. I am your endearing string host, Matt Soroka. As always, I'm joined by the button lover, Jar Soroka.
Hey, Matt. Yeah, you know what I did this morning?
You're back home.
I am back home, yes. So you can see I'm back in my office.
Okay.
So
welcome back.
This morning I had to, for my day job, I had to play with some sound effects. And in the process, I found a whole bunch of our old sound effects and a soundboard ready to go that we haven't used in years.
I discovered, Josh, later for the show, a stat of the day, stat of the week, if you will. So can you prepare a button for my stat of the week later? Yeah. I know that. Oh yeah,
Does that work? We just destroy your bit at the very beginning.
Yeah. So when you hear that noise, you know I'm about to drop the stat of the day.
I mean, I've got a lot more if you really, if you're looking for something else.
No, I mean you are the button lover, so feel free to hit all those buttons. I think half of them probably involve Bert sound effects.
Yeah, so. Noises Bert made with his mouth.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you find, do you have a little JJ Hardy in there?
Oh, I would.
That was one of my favorites.
Let me see.
Yeah.
They're not organized in any way. I just kind of found them here in a soundboard ready to go.
All right.
Some of them are real old, like this.
You're just a ball bag, ball bag, ball bag, a ball bag, my friend.
Hey, ball bag. How you doing?
Oh, yeah. We used to take listener questions.
Yeah.
I forgot we even did that.
Yeah. That was before people could comment just live during the show.
Yeah. We would get the questions ahead of time and ask them. It reminded me, too, of this weekend when we used to have Jimmy come on to do this weekend previews.
Yeah. Looking at the upcoming games. I guess we must have recorded later in the show, like, or later in the week. So we do like I think maybe Wednesday or Thursday.
We do a preview of the upcoming.
And we bring in a guy to come on for the, with something like this.
That's right.
I'll be making love to my man. Oh, yes, I will.
Listeners don't know now. We used to have a very segmented show. Like we would go segment to segment to segment and then we would, now. In our older age, we don't care anymore, and we don't do segments, and we just talk.
To the point that we mentored all the other shows to build segments into their shows.
Yeah, so and now their shows are better than our show.
Yeah,
so
if you listen to another Orioles podcast that does segments, we push them to do the segments.
We invented the segment idea of any podcast. Yes.
But then we've relaxed. I think I still like the idea that we bring back a segment or two, and we even if it's a simple one segment that we do at the end of the show,
like stat of the day. I've got the stat of the day segment ready for you. I'm pumped about the stat.
Yeah, we'll do stat of the day.
This is not going to be a recurring segment though, because I'm not going to hunt for stats, but I found this one stat.
No, but we'll have stat of the day on occasion. We could even have former Oriole of the day, which will always be this one button.
I'm Jonah Heim, and you're listening to Section 336.
World Series winner.
Yeah. Can we do? Usually we do obscure Orioles who are in Japan or not playing in the league anymore. Or we could do a kind of former World Series winning former Orioles if we want to go that route too. I'm sure.
Do you know where this song's going?
No, I have no idea.
In 2007, signed with Baltimore. By 2011, he pitched the home opener. But he was only good at landing other
teams. I don't remember this at all.
So they sent him to Chicago for Feldman and Clevenger. Airy, airy.
Marietta, Jake and his kick-ass beard.
I have no recollection. I mean, I have recollection of Jake Arrieta leaving and turning into a Cy Young. I have no recollection of that song, though.
I do not either. But it's on my soundboard here. So at some point we used it. There was a point where we were going through and we had lots of songs about Orioles. We had the guy on that would that wrote us a Section 336 theme song and lots of songs about Oriole players. And then suddenly the Orioles had no relevant players. So we had no more songs.
Mm. Yeah. All right. Josh, we have some stuff to get to today. We're another week out of the trade deadline. We finally, thank goodness, wrap up the month of July.
Yes.
We've been on the month of July. We didn't really talk at all about the performance on the field last week because we got so caught up in trades. And, I mean, breaking news last episode, Jackson Holiday call up, and now we got Sensen, we got Kobe Mayhew.
Yep.
So a lot happening. We got the trade candidates or the trade acquisitions actually playing in games.
Yeah, and we got to see Holiday and Mayo playing games. It was a busy week.
Yeah, hitting back-to-back. It's kind of fun.
Yeah.
Or striking out and hitting back-to-back, to be more accurate. We also have some of the most outrageous news of the season. But I want to start with the month of July. Josh, we're in August now. But yeah,
this is normally when we get into football talk.
Right.
Last year we did not, and thankfully this year we do not have to get into football talk yet.
If you look at Orioles' record by month, March was 2-1. That's our best winning percentage, 667 of the season, with that 2-1. April 17-9, May 17-9, talk about consistency. June 17-12, still very consistent. July.
June was the hard month.
June was a gauntlet. We said if we survive June, we're going to the World Series. And 17-12 is a phenomenal accomplishment for who we were playing. And then July 12-13, under 500.
Yeah. It stings.
2-2 for August so far.
Yeah. Real bad July.
Bad July. And the schedule was easier.
It was supposed to be easier. You still got to, it's back to that. You got to play the games because things happen. People get hurt. Westberg's out, broke his hand this week. That's something else we got to talk about.
Oh, shoot. We haven't talked about that yet either.
No, that happened and cleared the way for Mayo eventually.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, we did not talk about Varvara's experience with the Orioles this week.
Yeah. Or Soto's.
Or Soto's experience overall.
Yeah.
Or the backup catcher that we brought up, just in case McCann wasn't okay.
Yeah. All right, so we'll get to some of that stuff. But big picture, Josh, after the month of July, under 500, we split with Cleveland, which feels like a win after losing the first two games. Feel pretty good now.
Yes.
This conversation might be a little bit different if we, you know, went 1-3 or got swept. But how are we feeling now about the Orioles after going through this rough month and not playing great baseball? We've seen a lot of errors. We've seen a lot of bad pitching. We've seen a little bit of it all.
We've seen a lot of the bats completely shut down. That's concerning. But that's what makes baseball great. Is it's 162 games. You're going to have your ups. You're going to have your downs. Cleveland, if we did not split with Cleveland, I would have felt still pretty bad. But I feel pretty good. We're going into Toronto and into Tampa. We have good luck there. We got the Nats. We got the Red Sox. The Red Sox are the ones that's the tough four-game series that I have marked for this month is the Red Sox and the way they've been playing. Thankfully, that's in Baltimore. Then we got the Mets, the Astros, the Dodgers. Obviously, Dodgers are going to be tough. And Colorado. So I'm not too worried about this month, and I'm not worried at all about the season overall.
At all?
No, not really. I am happy with our pitching staff right now. I'm really enjoying Zach Eflin as an Oriole. So knowing that when we get into the postseason, I have Burns, Rodriguez, and Eflin, I feel confident with that. The only fear I have is the bats drying up. Okay. And we got to figure that out.
Okay. Okay. I just want to say
you've got major issues.
Josh,
are you con-
we've been doing this podcast for a while.
Yes.
And your explanation, your comment, what you just said right there is one of the dumber things I've ever heard. Okay.
What are you talking about?
It's one of the most uninformed. You should go to Bird's Eye View where they have baseless opinion. All right. Because that is a baseless, uninformed take.
What did you not like? What did you not like of my stat that I like?
Oh, how about this, Josh? How about this?
I'm happy with three pitchers.
How about this, Josh? In the month of July.
Yes.
In terms of, I don't know, what stat do we want to look at here? OPS is a good offensive stat.
Something on stupid, base like plus, Bart would say. Bucka bucka or wuzzle wuzzle. Something like that.
No, it's not wuzzle wuzzle. OPS, on base plus slugging, a pretty decent offensive stat.
Yeah.
Where do you think we would rank in baseball just for the month of July where we struggled?
I would think middle of the group. I would think middle.
Six. Number all six. Right. All right. So
you're
it's not
attacking me for not being positive enough.
But Josh, where does the pitching? In that same month, we had an ERA of about five.
Yeah, I would think middle.
24th in all of baseball.
Okay.
The problem was and is never about hitting.
But is it?
It's not about hitting. The offense is not. Josh, we still are ranked, second or third in overall runs scored this year?
No, but it's because we're
first in home runs, we'll first in OPS in all of baseball. It's the hitting has not and will not be an issue with this team.
No. It's inconsistent. The hitting is inconsistent. We will score 9 runs, then 10 runs, then 0-0-0-2-1. It's inconsistent.
Okay.
If you look, we won Sunday. We scored 9 runs. We scored 7 runs. 4 runs and 3 runs were the 2 losses. Those are tough because the pen gave up a bunch of runs.
Right.
So it's hard for me to say that. And I'm kind of talking myself out of my thought. I thought we had a lot of low scoring games that we lost, but it seems like when we don't score a lot, the pitching also gives up a lot right now for July.
Yeah. I mean, and to your point about inconsistency, I get it. But on the other hand,
are you more worried about the rotation or the pen?
The pitching and the pitching, Josh.
Both.
All of it.
So that's both.
All
both.
Of it.
Okay.
Both. But the hitting is not concerned. Like, I mean, people making a big deal at Adley Rutschman struggling or something.
All right.
And people make it just like people make a big deal when people have a rough week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks. This is baseball. Everyone has a rough 2 or 3 weeks. Everybody. But the fact is, we have enough, and I know we have some young players, but we have enough players who have hit well enough for a long period of time. They've made adjustments. Yeah. I think we can say that Gunnar Henderson's going to be all right, that he's a good hitter. I think we can say that Colton Cowles is a good hitter. I think we can say that Adley Rutschman's a good hitter. Even if they have a bad week or two, for the season, we still have one of the best hitting teams in baseball. Even when they struggle in July, 6 in baseball. And that's a struggling team.
What about the errors? Obviously. Are you concerned about the errors?
Yeah, the errors are weird.
Because that's part of that.
That goes hand in hand with the pitching. Yes, I agree. The fielding and the pitching concern me a lot more than the hitting. It's interesting that fielding was struggling, and then they caught up Kobe Mayo, whose his biggest red flag has been fielding.
Yes.
But they wanted that offense, even though I don't think they really need the offense. I think. My concern has been and still lies with pitching. I mean, we still don't have a reliable closer.
Correct.
And
I don't like Kimbrel in that 9-hole. I prefer Cano in that 9-hole, but I don't. Yeah, it would have been nice to get one at the trade deadline. We don't have any coming. What we've got is what we've got.
Yeah. No. Yeah. This is our team. I like Kimbrel. I mean, I like Cano in the 8th though, but. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know who I would have close.
If you put Cano in the 8th, who do you put in the 9th?
Right, I know.
Would you rather?
I don't know.
Again,
not Sir Anthony Dominguez. I don't trust him either. Certainly not this Gregory Soto character.
Do you need a closer, or is it time to forget the closer and you put Cano in there for the bigger at bats?
Yeah,
it's the 8th inning, the 9th inning. Whoever's got the bigger matchups, that's when you bring Cano in.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, we've been talking about that, I feel like, for years.
Yeah, I mean, don't know why they don't do it.
Like, in the 8th inning, if you have their 3, 4, and 5 are coming up, then let Cano pitched their 3, 4, and 5s.
And you think Cano would be amped up to be like, yeah, I'm going to take down the big guys.
Yeah, yeah, I think he likes the moment.
But do you need? But do you think you also need to let Cano face the back of the lineup to help his stats be better and confidence build up?
Yeah, I think,
I don't know if you're always facing the best guys. If you're the pitcher they bring in to pitch to Aaron Judge every time he's up, your confidence is going to go down.
Well, and I think there is a mentality here. Like, people like to know their role.
Correct.
Right. Yes. People like to know if they're eighth inning, ninth inning. And I mean, the advantage to Kimbrel is he's done it and been successful, really successful for a long time. So you know he can do it.
Right.
I think Hyde has gotten a little bit silly with some of his usage, with too much and too long of a break. And I think that's fair. That the usage is a little silly. I don't care about
him bringing guys in too early, like not letting the starter get out of the inning.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I have issues with how he kind of over relies on all the matchups. And now his bullpen between lefties and righties, and offensively between righties and lefties, is built for Hyde to platoon all the heck out of every game. And that's fine.
I believe that I've convinced myself that Manager Hyde was not supposed to be the manager this year. That Manager Hyde is the manager this year because he lucked into Manager of the Year last year.
They could have fired him after manager.
I really think looking back, Hyde might have been a placeholder manager as they prepared Brad Brock.
You don't mean Brad Brock. I don't mean Brad Brock.
I mean Brad Britton.
Yeah, it's not Brad, it's Buck Britton. Okay.
Oh, Buck Britton. I
can't believe I'm doing this podcast with you.
Okay. I can't believe I'm getting all the names wrong today. I really believe the way they've held everyone in AAA and then now bringing them up, and now you've got a—
Where's Buck Britton's call up?
I think the plan was Buck Britton would come up with these boys.
But they don't want to mess with the service time?
No, he's got no service time. But you're in this awkward spot that you can't fire manager of the year.
Yeah. Hey, I want to make an argument here, though, Josh, that I think this month of July, which has been rough, is really good for the Orioles. And maybe it's because I've been reading this book. You hear this book everyone's talking about? I'm a little bit late for it.
What is it?
The Anxious Generation.
No, I have not read The Anxious Generation.
All right. Well, it was the hot book maybe 6 months ago. I'm a little behind on this.
Okay.
I'm just reading that. It's all about how our kids, you know, are little snowflakes and they're soft and they spend
a bunch of strawberries.
Yeah, a bunch of strawberries. And one of the arguments he makes in there is this argument of anti-fragility, that they need experiences when they're young to like get them to be a little bit tougher, and they need to face some adversity. They need to face hardship because ultimately this will make them stronger, you know, less fragile as they get older and better able to handle the complex road.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
We've heard this and we've had this conversation before about when guys are given everything and they're baseball players coming up and they're the best at everything their entire career. Like, they never learned how to lose and how to adjust.
Sure. And I think we see examples of this on a small player-to-player level that has shown great success. Grayson Rodriguez, right, last year struggled, sent down to AAA, called back up a lot better. Kjerstad, similar, struggled in his first stint with the Orioles, called back up, much more successful. To a lesser extent, Stowers. Now we're seeing it kind of an extreme example with Jackson Holliday. Was terrible when he first caught up, had those struggles, called back up again, and is freaking every at bat is amazing.
He crushes that ball when he makes contact. I didn't realize
it doesn't matter. Fastball, curveball, he seems to be able to handle. And the only time he gets out is when umpires, you know, blow the call.
Oh, his strike zone is so wide.
Yeah. And I mean, I tell Silas, like, watch this guy at every at bat at 20. Yeah. He just has such a good idea of what he wants to do, what balls to swing at.
And you're right. There's definitely. You know, there's a determination there in Holliday of, I struggled coming up. I gotta earn that back, and I gotta prove that I deserve to be up there.
Yeah, and that struggling was good for him. And the next time he has kind of a little bit of slump, he can draw on this experience and grow from it. Gunnar Henderson talks about a similar stuff about you know, working out of a slump last year, and And I think that's a microcosm for the Orioles team in July. Like, I want my team to experience some struggles. I don't want them to experience enough struggles to lose the AL East, but this has been the perfect situation, Josh, where they have struggled, which I think is good for them in the long term. They'll learn from these struggles and be better for it. And the Yankees stink. They can't win enough, so we didn't lose the AL East, and so we're still sitting tied in first place. While also we had this opportunity to face some hardships, face some adversity, face some challenges, which I think is good for any baseball team to go through, as long as, you know, you can come out the other side. And we've, I think we've done that. And I think we're going to have a really good month of August. I hope our bullpen can hang in there. I hope our starters can get deep into games. And our offense is going to be great the month of August. I think it's going to be fantastic. We have the best nine-hole hitter in baseball to complement a good offense.
Well, they're gonna have to. They're gonna move him up.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He's gonna be the nine-hole probably not this week.
I agree. But and I think, hey, props to Hyde too for messing with the lineup, bringing Cowser to lead off, moving Adley Rutschman down, Santander up. Like, I think that was good tweaking of the lineup by Hyde. Actually, I like that a lot. And so, you know, I think all those struggles are better for us in the long term. So I'm happy. I'm happy we had a losing record in July. I'm happy we struggled because, again, I don't care about our record in July. I care about our record in October. And I think some of this adversity can help serve us in the long run.
Yeah, and you're right. To have that adversity, to struggle in July and still come out of July in first place is huge. And it's now, let's go into August. Let's take it back and let's get out of this thing.
Judge, though, what are your thoughts on, we have an identical record, 67-46, yes, to the New York Yankees. However, if I go to fangraphs.com, they say that the Yankees have a 59% chance of winning the division. I'm sorry. Yeah, of winning the division. And we have a 40% chance,
yeah,
of winning the division. What say you? Why do they have
it's
19% higher chance
because it's when Yankee we have the same bias. Record? It's Yankee bias.
We even by fangraphs.com, who rely on, you know, numbers and Zips projections and Steamer or whatever.
They don't rely on just numbers. They rely on numbers. And there's always a little lean on the lever. There's always a little weighted, oh, they're the New York Yankees.
Oh, you think that's part of the calculation? Yes. One of the things in there is Yankees?
Yes. Is it the Yankees?
How many wins is being a Yankee worth?
Well, it just leans on the scale a little bit.
Leans on the scale. I gotcha. All right.
No, I think I don't.
You think we're going to win the AL East?
I think the Yankees have struggled. Well, clearly, look at the records. They're tied. The Yankees have struggled just as much as the Orioles this season. The difference is the Orioles have done it in clumps at the same time as the Yankees, because the Orioles struggles have happened while they're in first place, but the Yankees struggled at the exact same time, so they never lost first place. I think for Saturday afternoon, we were in second place from the time their game ended to our game ended. For like 4 or 5 hours, we were in second place. Other than that, we've been ahead of them. So yeah. I'm not concerned. I don't see, I'm sure, you know what that lean in is? It is probably a strength of schedule lean that gives the Yankees that extra 20%. But that's a huge percent to give for strength of schedule. I don't have the Yankee schedule in front of myself, but the Orioles schedule is not impossible for the next 2 months.
I don't think there's a big difference in strength in schedule. Strength of schedule.
No, I don't know. Then it's got to be Yankee bias.
Yeah. I mean, even if you look at the trade deadline now, I think the Yankees added Mark Leiter, De Los Santos for the bullpen. And I think of course, Jazz Chisholm Jr. So they made some additions, but not crazy additions. They didn't, I think, significantly upgrade their roster. I think they did about as much as the Orioles did.
Right.
So I don't think the advantage there is Yankees because of what they did in the trade deadline.
I don't think so.
Yeah. I don't either.
Yeah. I mean, I guess their bullpen's probably better than ours. Where we've had a better offensive, they probably have better pitching. But I don't have a great answer for you on why that would make them 19% or higher than us.
Yeah. I mean, it's all projecting what they're going to do for the rest of the season. And yeah, I mean, but that's been, it's been true all season, right? Like, this is not a new development. Every time we've been really close in record, they've been had a much higher, you know, playoff chance. So the whatever the system has liked the Yankees all year. Hey, speaking of, I mentioned the trade deadline, and I don't know if you have any more thoughts kind of 2 weeks out of the trade deadline. I don't know if you're ever, you know, either Mike Elias is GM of the year for Eloy Jimenez, or he should be fired for, you know, the Rodgers and his struggles. It's hard to react to just 2 weeks, but looking at the trade, I'm impressed with Jimenez. Well, we'll see how that works out.
I don't know. What's he have? Two hits so far as an Oriole?
She had three yesterday.
Oh, never mind. He is. You're right. He had three yesterday. He is 5 for 9.
Yeah.
With the Orioles. But he is just a straight DH. You're not going to put him out in the field.
He's a platoon DH.
He's a platoon big.
Yeah. Though he played against a righty, he got three hits. Yeah, yesterday.
Yeah.
So, but my kind of, I have two thoughts I just want to bring up about the trade deadline. One is I'm still mad, and I mentioned this last week. I'm still mad that we couldn't get a better closer, that we couldn't upgrade there. And I think there was two closers traded. The Angels traded their closer and Tanner Scott.
Yeah.
And that's kind of it. I think part of this was just a lack of.
Well, why was Mason Miller not traded?
Injured.
Because he's injured? Is he out for a year?
He's out for a while.
Oh, okay. Then I missed that.
Yeah.
I
know it would have been interesting if Mason Miller was available, though he would have been really expensive. There was, you know, Josh, are you aware of this? There was not a single top 100 prospect traded at the deadline.
Really?
Yeah.
That's part of baseball now, where the trade deadline is a little weird because so many teams are still in that wild card hunt.
Yeah, there weren't a lot of sellers.
Like, our big trades were with the Phillies.
Yeah.
And the Phillies are in the hunt as much as we are.
Yeah. 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 So I think there was a dearth of quality back end arms available, which means the price for Scott was very high.
Went up. It was too high
for a rental. And one would argue too high. And so it didn't happen. And so, I mean, I understand why it didn't happen, why we didn't walk away with a new closure at the deadline.
Right.
It's still frustrating.
Yeah.
No, because I think the moves we made help us win the AL East, and they make us. I think the Eflin is a big addition for the playoffs. The Rodgers, I don't think he'll play in the playoffs. But I think another bullpen arm to pitch the 8th or 9th would have been huge for the playoffs. We'll see what happens with Sir Anthony Dominguez and Soto. But so far, I'm not that impressed.
No, me either. Were you surprised Cole Irvin, that no one picked Cole Irvin up?
Yeah, I think that's good.
I think that's great for us.
Yeah.
I was surprised.
Goodness knows we could use the depth.
That no one wanted him because he started the season real strong. So hopefully he can get back to that down at AAA and come out and help our pen.
Yeah, and he's in a little weird situation where I think the Orioles, just because, you know, the situations, he was kind of yo-yoed a bit, right?
He was.
Bullpen to starts. I feel like it's hard to get in that consistent routine when we're not getting a consistent role with the team. So I think he probably suffered from that. But yeah, and my other takeaway. So one is, we didn't get a better reliever. And part of that is just, I think, the market. My second observation is, I think we were a little bit higher on Norby and maybe even Stowers than the rest of baseball. Specifically Norby.
Considering that he's in Jacksonville now, just like me?
Yeah, two reasons. Once, he was sent to go with Josh in Jacksonville, which I think is a mistake.
Well, they want him to learn third base.
Yeah, that's fine. But also, I don't know if you saw this, Josh. Fangraphs released this article by Eric Loggenhagen, who knows his stuff, about prospects, and they ranked all the prospects that were traded at the deadline. Okay?
Yeah.
Do you know where Norby ranks in terms of all the prospects? Where would you guess you would rank?
150.
Just the prospects traded deadline. There weren't 150 prospects traded at the deadline.
Oh, I thought you meant overall, and I knew you said no top 100, so I was picking out.
No. So, like, the best prospect was Augustin Ramirez, who was traded from Yankees to Miami.
He should be middle of the pack because there's always the no-name, low-level guys.
I'm going – oh, man, they're not even numbered. Are they? Oh, yeah, here they're numbered. So, like, number, for example, for context
– Wes Towers.
He's not on the list because technically he's not a prospect. Okay. So he's not even on the list.
All right.
But I'll give you another, like Mac Horvath, for example.
Yeah.
He was ranked 22. He's the 22nd best prospect.
All right. So I'm guessing because you're bringing him up at 22, that Norby fell down to like 29.
Yeah, 28.
Okay.
They had Seth Johnson, Orioles pitcher, ahead of him, Jack Bowmeister ahead of him, Orioles pitcher, Mac Horvath. So he was not that whole trade where we traded the whole trade for Eflin was better prospects than Norby. Two better prospects than Norby. So 28th. And then Stowers isn't on the list because he's no longer considered a prospect. So we traded, you know, the 28th best guy in all those trades and Zach Stowers. All that to say is I think maybe in Birdland we overvalued what Connor Norby is. Especially, I feel like third base is like a power hitting position. I don't know if Norby can put up those power numbers to justify hitting at third base. But I think with his success, he was a bit overvalued by Orioles. But we kind of see his true value there.
And it also speaks to why we didn't have a clear path for him in the big leagues. Because he wasn't banging on the door like other players were.
Right. And even if he was the next guy up, next year long term, he's down that list.
Yes, correct.
And Orioles see it that way, and clearly other teams see it that way too. And so it makes sense. I think at the time we're like, what? Norby Stowers for Rogers? Is that the best we get? I think in retrospect, it makes more and more sense to me. Now, I still like Norby and thinking he'd be a good everyday player in the majors, but clearly I don't think there's agreed consensus about that across baseball. All right. I thought that was interesting.
You mentioned Jimenez and that you've obviously liked what you've seen out of him. What about Austin Slater? He led off yesterday.
Led off. This is the guy who's like DFA candidate for the Reds. And now all of a sudden he's batting leadoff for our playoff lead team. That's kind of wild.
He's taking Kjerstad's spot basically in the line in the 26 man.
Right. It's another platoon nonsense situation, right? He's a right-handed hitter. In a team stacked with left-handed hitting outfielders, including Kjerstad, the left-handed outfielder. So we needed he's like the Austin Hayes replacement, right?
Right. So how do we get Kjerstad back on this team? Kjerstad got sent down. So I keep looking at the roster and I'm like, all right, well, to make room for Kjerstad, you need to clear Slater, Jimenez, Ryan O'Hearn, or Ramon Urias. Those are your bench guys.
Right. And it's not going to happen with any of them. And it's interesting, right? Mike Elias said, I think
Kjerstad would be a big part of our second half.
He said this. And then
3 days before DFA.
3 days later, he's sent down to the minors and no path to come back.
There's no path. The only path is an injury.
Yeah.
Because you're not going to dump Urias. You've kept him this long.
Oh, and he's your backup infielder.
Yeah, you're right. With Mateo, until Mateo comes back, and remember, Mateo has to come back at some point.
Maybe.
Ideally.
There's no set date for his return. Yeah.
Right. But ideally, you would want him back. So he's another guy that you got to make room for. And I guess it's really going to be dependent on these new guys, Jimenez and Slater, performing.
Well, and Slater makes sense because he can play all the outfield positions. He's right-handed, and he's speed and good defensively. So he's your leading defensive replacement. He's your pinch runner, and he's also can play all the outfield positions. Kjerstad's below average defensively, is below average speed, and can't play all the outfield positions.
right.
So, yeah, he's not the Slater replacement. And Eloy Jimenez is right-handed. And, you know, so that becomes, do you want to carry another left-handed? Like, he could be the left-handed hitting DH, but then you know, it gets weird with Ryan O'Hearn.
Right, so that's Ryan O'Hearn's role.
Right. Now, I would argue you can move Ryan O'Hearn to first base and let Kjerstad play, and that means you bench Mountcastle against...
Right, you platoon Mountcastle.
...righties, which is tough. But maybe that's... All that's to say, John, I think it's outrageous. I think this is outrageous. I think it's absolutely outrageous that Heston Kjerstad is being screwed like this. And if I'm Heston Kjerstad, I'm ticked off. If I'm his agent, I'm telling his agent, get me out of here. It's outrageous.
Well, you were upset before that Kjerstad wasn't being caught up.
Well, Josh,
but now that he's got sent right back down. Yeah, it's irritating.
Here's something for you, Josh. Here's something for you. Again, look at the stat of OPS. Look at who is on base plus slugging at Norfolk. Heston Kjerstad, better OPS than Kobe Mayo, better OPS than Jackson Holliday, than Connor Norby, than Kyle Stowers, all of them. He leads right. the team in OPS. He's batting at Norfolk 300, OBP of 400, had less strikeouts than Mayo, less strikeouts than Holliday.
Well,
He's had an offensively a better season, those guys. And it's not like this is some rum-dum who's just having a good season. This is the number two overall pick in the draft. This was a top 100 prospect. And now he can't even make the squad. And he's 25. What? It's not like he's 22. He's 25. It's outrageous he can't stick.
And what I don't get is he is a left-handed bat. And I know you mentioned, well, we got Ryan O'Hearn as the left-handed bat. Ryan O'Hearn's the only other left-handed bat we have on the bench. Slater's right-handed. Jimenez is right-handed. Urias is right-handed.
Right. Well, if you look at the outfield,
McCann's right-handed, if you want to include him.
Yeah. Well, Josh, I'll tell you what. If here's the reality, and I think it's outrageous, and I think Kjerstad has earned every right to be in the majors, and I'm almost like, you got to demand a trade, dude. But, and we'll talk about his long-term future. I want to make a point about his long-term future here, too. Or if we should just trade him now.
No, but, you would think he's younger. He should have more of a long-term future than Jimenez.
Maybe not. I want to get to that in a second.
We've said all season the knock against him is the field. The knock against Norby is the field, the defense. That Mayo, the knock is the defense. That we can't be a team that carries an exclusively DH guy. And now we're carrying an exclusively DH.
Right, and Jimenez. Now, the problem is outfield positions, he's left-handed, and Couser's left-handed, and Mullins is left-handed, and yes. Santander hits left-handed. Like, he's a switch hitter. Yeah,
he's a switch.
And so there's really, offensively, you could say, well, there's no spot for him.
Except for the DH.
And the reality of it is, Josh, if Heston Kjerstad was a third baseman, he'd be here. Yes. Whether he hit left-handed or right-handed, he'd be here because we need a third baseman. We don't need a corner outfielder.
But what's he doing in Norfolk? He's not playing a first or third. He's not playing a corner position.
Right, I know. He's playing outfield.
Right.
So can Heston not play first?
I feel like he's played it a little bit at AAA.
Yeah. I think he has to.
I assume the idea is that Kjerstad... You want him next year when you see maybe Mullins have another drop off. Maybe you're moving on from Mullins. No, you're moving Couser to second center, and now you can.
I mean, I think this. I mean, it could be. I don't foresee Couser. Yeah, I think the question is: this is the final year of Santander's contract.
Correct.
I think the big question is: Santander's having a career freaking year. He's going to make some money.
Yes.
I mean, this is Joe Flacco territory. He just needs to go and win the World Series MVP and then cash in Joe Flacco style. I mean, he has made himself a ton of money this year.
You know what they said about Joe Flacco.
What they say about Joe Flacco.
I think Joe Flacco is actually a very elite quarterback. He won a Super Bowl. He did it really, to a certain extent, with that great arm of his. I would say absolutely he is an elite quarterback.
But is Santander an elite outfielder, Josh?
This season, he's having an unbelievable year. The month of June alone was elite.
Yeah. And he's kept it up through July.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't complain.
Yeah, like home run like every nine at-bats now. So,
but do we give him that money?
Right, this is going to be the question. If Santander is extended, and you can make an argument that he's had a great year, deserves extension, we have the money now, let's do it. I think it kind of permanently blocks Kowser. I mean, I'm sorry, Kjerstad. Because even if Mullins is not the long-term solution at center field, I think he is for next year. And I don't know how they feel about Kowser going there. And I don't know how confident you feel about Santander, Kowser, and Kjerstad with that big old left field at Camden Yards. I don't even know how confident they feel about that.
Yeah,
and
I don't like Kjerstad. I mean,
if Santander
can play it a little bit.
Right. If Santander isn't here, Kjerstad slides easily into right field, and there's your answer. He becomes your everyday right fielder. And maybe that's a long-term plan. But with the year Santander is having, maybe that changes the equation a little bit because Santander's been so freaking good. So,
but does giving Santander a huge contract make it tough to then extend Gunnar and Adley down the road?
Yeah, I mean, it depends. I mean, if you do, like, first of all, I don't think money is an object for Rubenstein. That's what I've been told. But also, if you do like a 3 or 4 year deal for Santander, then I think you can also do it for Gunnar. And listen, I don't know. It's hard to envision a world where you can extend, because they're all going to come up around the same time, right? Rutschman, Rodriguez, Gunnar, Holiday. They're all going to come up within a year or two.
Yes.
I don't think you'll extend all of them.
No. Well, that's why you got Pasalo sitting down there. Unfortunately, yeah. Unfortunately, when you look at our minors.
Well, we can have this conversation in 5 years.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah. I think a lot can happen between now and then.
The only extension I want locked in now is Corbin Burns. I do not want to see Corbin Burns leave. I would spend all my money on keeping Corbin Burns here as that foundation of the rotation.
He made a quote before his start the other day saying he's that Baltimore's been good to him.
That's good. Let's be better. Let's roll out the Brinks truck. Let's get I guess it'd be T. Rowe Price trucks. Let's get T. Rowe Price down there. Let's plan on, I'm sure they've got those financial experts at T. Rowe Price that do like life savings and retirement planning. Let's work it out and plan with him on how to retire as an Oriole.
Yeah. Switching gears a little bit, and I completely agree with you, but Jordan Westberg's injury.
Yeah.
We touched on this a little bit. It sucks. It sucks for him because he's having such a great year. Yeah. He's exceeded all expectations. How big of a deal is this kind of broken hand thing for the Orioles?
I think Westberg was really becoming a solid bat on this lineup. I think he was becoming a huge part of this team. What it does now is buy more life for Ramon Urias.
He's staying.
He's staying. And his last 2 weeks must have been hilarious. Feeling like he's up and down, going to get cut. Oh, wait, no, we didn't make a trade. Oh, this. We trade Norby, make some room. He can relax. So the fact that he stuck around, now we need him. He's going to be on that bench with Mateo hurt and Westberg hurt. And it sucks because I really enjoy watching Westberg play. And I know the relationship between Westberg and Gunnar and Adley and Kowser, like they want to win this thing all together. And to have one guy on the bench hurt, it reminds me of when Matt Wieters got hurt when we were making a playoff push.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we've had a bad history, Nick Markakis, a bad history of injuries right before playoffs. Now, the hope is, I think, that he can still come back.
For the postseason.
And I think that'd be a great addition.
Yes.
Yeah, I think our offense, again, I think our offense is so good. It doesn't suffer a lot. Kobe Mayo has struggled so far. And Jordan Westberg, he just seems like such a polished, at 25, just such a polished offensive player and such a great year. So I think it is a blow. But I think because our offense is good, it hurts less than, let's say, a Kyle Bradish, which was, I think, a devastating injury that we don't talk enough about.
Right. No, Westberg has been solid, but he's just been in the shadow of Gunnar and Adley his entire career.
Right. Yeah, as far as wasn't highly ranked prospect, wasn't drafted as high as those guys. Yeah.
But you're right. When you go back and look at the injuries that screwed us this year, Westberg's pretty minor. You're going to talk about Bradish and Means as being the big ones.
Yeah, to me, Bradish.
And maybe Batista, even though it was an injury of last year.
Yeah.
Having that guy hurt all year when you desperately need a closer that you can rely on.
Oh, yeah. I mean, if you put Batista on this team right now, I feel like we're we're World Series favorites. I feel like we're that shift for the Yankees in the playoff odds shifts right to the Orioles.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, so that's
what's exciting about next year. But I sure would like to win it this year and go and defend it next year.
Yeah. No, I agree. I agree. And I think this, I wonder, I'm also curious about Kobe Mayo. And I'm glad he got caught up, even though those numbers aren't as good as Kjerstad's, because his numbers were great. And I think we're going to see the same thing, right, with Holiday, with Holiday. I think Mayo will struggle. We'll give him three weeks, and then he gets sent down.
And then he continues to struggle. Yeah,
he'll get sent down. And then he gets caught back up. I think that's I'm calling it right now. He'll struggle for a few weeks, then he'll get sent down.
Well, but remember, there's only 3-4 weeks left of AAA ball.
Oh, did that season end sooner?
I believe they end at the end of August.
Okay. Well, yeah, and then you have September call-ups.
Right.
Which I assume Kjerstad will be there for September call-ups. I assume he's the guy. If he can stay down there, you know, if they don't call him up before then, I assume he's your September call-up guy. But.
Hey, how about we take a break? How about we take a break right here?
Okay, and after the break, I'm going to do my stat, my stat of the day.
And I want to hear about your trip to Miami as well.
Oh, yeah, sure.
All right, we're back, Matt.
All right, let me.
I see the spot for ads, so I get to pay you now.
Thank you. I appreciate it. It's about time, doing this show for how many freaking years. Here's my stat of the day. Josh, our pitching ERA. Let me see if I can get this right. Our pitching ERA this season, we're ranked 11th overall in pitching.
Okay.
We have an ERA of 3.89. All right,
3.89.
Last year, all of last year, do you know what our ERA was last year?
For pitching, what our ERA was?
Yeah. I'll tell you what it was.
5.62.
It was 3.89.
Oh, we had a, okay.
And this year's 3.89. We have the identical pitching ERA that we did last year. But do you know what the difference is with last year and this year? Last year, in terms of
our bullpen. Last year, our bullpen was a lot stronger.
Well, whatever. And we can break down the pitching numbers. I'm just saying overall, the same as ERA. But last year, if you look at stats like OPS in hitting, the Orioles ranked 19th in baseball. If you look at a stat like home runs, 19th in baseball. If you look at a stat like runs scored, the Orioles were actually 7th in baseball. Pretty good for runs scored.
But you're saying our offense was not what it is this year. So you're saying pitching did a better job last year?
No, my point is
pitching's the same. So what's your point?
That right now the Orioles are a top three offense in every category. And last year they were middle of the road. So pitching wise, we're exactly where we were last year, but offensively we're much better.
Okay.
Home runs, we were 19th. This year we're first. Like
that's true.
We just are much more polished, and for reasons, right? Like, it's not randomly. Santander's having a great year. They merged with Colton Cowser.
Gunnar
Henderson, MVP, like, first half, and I think he's about to go on another streak here. Now more recently with Jackson Holliday. Like, I think Jordan Westberg's contributions.
Cowser, yeah. Colton Cowser leading right now for Rookie of the Year.
Yeah, so if you compare this year.
I put money on that one.
Yeah, if you compare this year to last year's 101-win team that made the playoffs, this year I think we're objectively better because our pitching is kind of just the same ERA-wise, and our hitting is far superior. Now, you mentioned it, and the one kind of I'm sure someone there is screaming out at me that we have Kimbrel instead of Bautista, and that is a significant change.
Huge difference.
That is a significant change compared to last year. And also other factors like, you know, you could say, well, Bradish was here, but now we have Burns. And I think that's a pretty fair trade-off. And now with Eflin, I think our starters can line up pretty well to what our starters were last year. And so it's just interesting. It seems like a similar team last year, but our offense is so much better this year. And so I think this team is better than last year. And I don't know if we're going to win 101 games or 102 games, but I do think we're going to win the AL East. And I do think it's interesting that our ERA, team ERA, is exactly the same as it was last year. But hopefully our hitting will see us through this year. And I just think, too, I don't want to rehash the whole playoff things, but I and the whole series. I mean, we were there. We saw it firsthand. I've been trying to block it out ever since. But it's just, you know, objectively speaking, it's impossibly objective. But if you look at the Rangers team last year, the Rangers returned a very similar team to last year than this year to the Orioles. The Rangers, right. I don't think, were all that much better than the Orioles.
No, they just got hot at the end.
Right. And we just had a series of unfortunate events. We just didn't play well. Part of that could have been kind of first time there, playoff atmosphere, whatever. We just played poorly. This year, I just feel like we're in position to not just get in the playoffs, but to do some damage the way our offense is set up, the way we have such balance. Now with the emergence of Jackson Holliday, I mean, there's just no weakness in this lineup. And I think we have just a really strong roster in terms of righty lefties too. My biggest concern is still that bullpen, but I just think we're set up to hopefully have 4-run leads going into the seventh and eighth and ninth in the playoffs.
Yeah. No, and we definitely, this team is different, as in this team, you feel like these bats are never out of it. It could be the bottom of the ninth down by 4 and you're still hopeful going into the inning. You look at the guys who are coming up and you're like, all right, those guys can get on base. We can knock one out. You trust these guys to win games.
Well, it's interesting because I remember at the beginning of the season, we were talking about how the Orioles were dominating in all these offensive categories, except there was one offensive category where they were bottom of the league and they were kind of struggling. And we're like, well, that's kind of weird. And that was with walks. Like, we were crushing everybody, you know, in all the kind of offensive categories, except for walks, we were dead last. But if you've been watching games recently, we're walking like crazy. I just looked it up. Over the last 15 games or 15 days, 14 games, we have 60 walks. That's first in baseball. Yeah, so we're just walking a lot more. We're being more patient. And it makes sense when you look at the approach of Jackson Holliday, which, have you noticed, he's got the same angry throwaway walk response as Gunnar Henderson. Yes. He's like a little mini Gunnar Henderson. Yeah. That's cool.
And Kobe Mayo started his career with a walk as well.
Yeah.
So it's nice to see that patience get to a full count and pull the walk out of it.
Yeah. And Jackson Holliday should have a couple more walks if umps were fair and not biased. And so just this team has just a much more patient approach. Again, I would argue anti-fragility, going through all those hardships of not walking and not getting good hitters counts, all that has served them well in the long run.
Yep.
And now we just seem like a really patient. And so the thing that was our weakness at the beginning of the season, not enough walks, we're doing really well at that. So I just think this is a team that's still offensively still getting better. And yeah, I'm excited for the month of August.
Agreed.
All right, real quick. I know we're running out of time here. Miami was awesome. So we got a hotel down there within walking distance. I used to walk as loosely. It was a good walk. It was like a 30-minute walk in Miami. Okay.
See, there's a hotel stayed at in Tampa that was literally walking distance, like a 5-minute walk. Okay. And it was wonderful.
Yeah. This is 30 minutes through a semi-shady area that I probably shouldn't have taken status through at night, but whatever. It was like a 30-minute walk. But I like walking in the cities too. So it's kind of cool to walk in the city. And Miami, I tell you what, I'm not a huge fan of Tampa Stadium. I'm a big fan of the indoor Miami Stadium.
Are you?
Yeah, see, the 70 degrees after walking 30 minutes and then the sun. My wife came to a game the first time. I think she had a positive experience at a baseball game in her life. It's just because she didn't have to deal with the hotness of a summer day. I liked the indoors. And it didn't feel like Tampa feels so cramped, whereas this did not feel as cramped.
Well, that's kind of like what I liked about Toronto. Every game I was there, the dome was open, but it still didn't feel like I was in an enclosed building, even though it was a dome.
Yeah. And everything is like unlike Tampa. Have you ever been to Tropicana Field?
Yeah, I've been to Tampa many times.
You've been to many Tropicana Field baseball games?
I've been to 5.
Okay. You know, like, it's not, you go through the tunnel and then there's these, you know.
Tropicana Field, you realize, is like 4 hours from me.
Okay, fine.
Like, I'm still debating about going this weekend.
Okay,
it's
fine.
Driving distance.
But like, it's all kind of, it feels enclosed. You got to go through the tunnel, and then the concessions are in the out. You can't even see the field when you're doing concessions.
They've cleaned that up a little bit in the outfield.
Have that.
Yeah, okay. They got rid of seats and made put concessions where seats were.
Okay. Well, that's how Miami is. It's all very open.
Right. I believe you were describing Camden Yards.
Yeah, but well, Camden Yards like that too.
You can't see anything.
Yeah, Camden Yards like that too. I always think of the opposite as, I remember, you know, back when they went to the Guardians game, and that was my first experience, I feel like, at a major league stadium where it was all open and you could go to concessions and still watch the game while you're waiting for a hot dog.
And I hate the Nats Park, but they have that as well.
Okay, yeah, you're right. They have that as well. And so I like that it's kind of open. The Bobblehead Museum, very underwhelming. I think you could put it, and it's not a museum, it's a display. You could put a better bobblehead display up there.
Well, I heard on the broadcast there were not many Oriole bobbleheads there, but it was a mixture. So it looked like to me, like if the Orioles did a bobblehead display like that, they could fill that thing up with just Oriole bobbleheads.
Yeah, absolutely. And there was one cool one that had, who was it? Oh, I'm going to scroll through my pictures and find it. That had kind of Earl Weaver and someone else on there. Maybe I think it was Earl Weaver and Jim Palmer.
Yeah, I've got it right here on my shelf.
Oh, you have that one?
Yeah, you want to see it?
That's the one I took a picture of. I was like, oh, Josh doesn't have this one. Josh should get this.
Hold on.
This dual bobblehead. But I mean, the best thing about the whole Miami experience is, I mean, ticket prices. I bought tickets for my family and you know, we were there with friends of ours. And so I got, I think it was 8 tickets. Oh, yeah, that's the one. That's a cool bobblehead. Yeah. Cool okay, bobblehead. All right.
Yeah. Like I said, I can do a better bobblehead display than Miami.
I know. It wasn't even like great Orioles bobbleheads. It was just kind of some random Orioles bobbleheads. But was the ticket price. I mean, I bought 8 tickets. I think the total was $60, which includes all the stupid fees that they charge you, which is literally half the price because the tickets were like $4. And then it was all the ticket fees. Just sit right. 8 rows back from the field. So the tickets were insanely cheap, which is great. I found a secret concession stand that had cheap food. And so the cost wise, which makes me so happy, it was relatively inexpensive, in terms of the food and everything.
Right.
And it was just, we got 3, balls are in batting practice. Josh, can you still go and see batting practice Camden Yards? I feel like I haven't seen batting practice forever.
But if you go to Camden Yards for batting practice, you're only going to see the visitor team. You can't get there early enough.
But they open the gates not early enough to see batting practice for the opponents?
No, I think only on Saturdays they open it up early enough that you can maybe catch the end of the Orioles batting practice.
Okay. Well, I mean, we got there real early. I guess on the first game we went to, was it the Wednesday night game? We saw batting practice, and we just Kjerstad was unbelievable.
Yeah, when you texted me about Kjerstad.
It was amazing watching Kjerstad. Like I didn't even need to see who was up. I just saw the ball fly. Oh, it's Kjerstad. That dude at batting practice, it's like nothing I've ever seen. And I didn't catch. I was really wanting to catch a batting practice ball. There's not a lot of us. Just a handful of us. Where the balls were getting hit, a player tossed Silas. You know, he got 3 balls, so he was happy. But we didn't catch any.
By Marlin players?
No, by Orioles guys in the outfield.
Okay, but no one shagging balls.
No, it was. I don't know who this guy was. Okay. He was not a player. He was like a. I don't know.
Ball boy.
I don't know who he was. He was too old to be a ball boy, but he had like a beard, like a full-grown man, but he didn't look athletic enough to actually be a baseball player.
Okay. So he was like he was like a dugout catcher.
Yeah. I also said, hey, Thias, look, it's Corbin Burns warming up. And Silas said, that's not Corbin Burns' dad. he said, Corbin Burns doesn't have a bun or red hair.
And I was what was it, Kramer?
No, it was Craig Kimbrell.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And I was like, are you sure? And then, you know, he got done and walked over and said, oh, yeah, it's Craig Kimbrell.
They should do? They should put numbers on people's shirts so you know who they are.
No, it was warm-ups. No one, they had their warm-up shirts on. No one had numbers.
Gotcha.
As if I would know his number. But no, so all that was cool. They have a cool little museum, which is nice. For the life of me, Josh, the only thing I don't understand is And they do a great job of also, like, everything's in Spanish and English. Everyone there is bilingual. All, like, the people, you could tell they all have accents. Not that an accent means you're bilingual, but, you know. You can just hear, like, everywhere you go, there's conversations happening in English and Spanish, everywhere you go.
Correct. That's Miami.
Yeah, they do a great job promoting that. What I don't understand is, you know, and we know that baseball is such a influence in Latin America.
Right.
We know the closeness of Cuba. I don't, for the life of me, understand why these games aren't, why there aren't more fans in the stands. It seems like a perfect baseball town with that Latin American influence. Miami has fully embraced it in kind of their promotion and their playing style. Why aren't they having more fans? I don't understand that. Seems to.
Well, I mean, I'm sure it's the crime and the snow and the traffic.
And school.
And school.
School hours. The traffic was a little bizarre. But Josh, you could pull up. Again, I get fixated on these things. I could drive my car and I walk 30 minutes like a schmuck, but I could drive right up next to the stadium and park for $10. And it was like lot A for the Orioles for $10. And you get out and walk. And it was open. Know.
It's the same reason with Tampa, where they'll blame the Tampa, they blame traffic. And I get that because those bridges are horrible.
Well, and the game's in St. Petersburg.
I don't know. I hear people all the time say, oh, well, it's because it's Miami. It's beautiful. There's all this other stuff to do. You guys in Maryland, all you have is baseball and football. But that doesn't stop the Dolphins from bringing fans in. Doesn't stop the Buccaneers from bringing fans in.
Yeah, even Miami Heat.
Right. So I don't know. I know the Marlins have a lot more games than these others. So you're comparing 81 games versus, oh, I have to be there one of these 8 games.
Right. I know, but that's true for every baseball team. And why can't Miami keep up with fans? And this is not just like a problem in 2024. This has historically been a problem for Miami, is getting fans, even when they've been good, I think. It just doesn't make sense to me. I just feel like in that culture, with that team who's embraced that culture, and with the culture of baseball, it seems to be like a really good mix.
I hear you. I wonder if that culture is more of a, like our kids, more player-focused rather than team-focused.
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't see, like, I didn't see hardly any kids there. Well, I did see, actually, because, oh my goodness, Josh, Thursday was the afternoon game, and it was camp day. And there was, behind us, a group of like 50 obnoxious kids screaming, throw me the ball, can I get a ball?
Oh, I hate that.
Kind of the worst. And it was camps everywhere. I'd never go to a game in Miami on camp day. That was the only negative, all these little kids. Other than that, no, I had a great time, a great experience. I would definitely make that Miami trip. We have friends who live close to there, so we stayed with them. So it worked out well for us. And so, yeah, I would definitely do that again.
According to the internet, the Marlins do not have fans because there's a diverse city with lots of different things to do.
I don't buy that.
The stadium location is not central to the Miami metropolitan area.
Yeah, I think that's fair. The location is a little bit weird.
Same argument we hear in Tampa. Ownership changes because the previous ownership was so bad. And now with the transition to Jeff Lura and Derek Jeter, it hasn't taken off yet.
Well, not Derek Jeter anymore. Yep. That's the old. That's,
exactly. So that goes back to that ownership changes.
Well, they have traded away all their good players. Every time they get good, they trade away all their good players. But again, I thought that was a problem.
And then they're saying
for the fans. But.
And they're saying it's similar to Washington, D.C., and it has a whole lot of transplants. And not a lot of whole people. So people come in.
But D.C. has good attendance.
Yeah, no, they don't.
Yes, they do, Josh.
Do they still have it this year?
All right, yes, even a stinky team, they have good attendance.
All right, well, the number one reason the Marlins don't have attendance is they suck.
Yeah, I agree.
It goes back to what we said for the Orioles for years. If you win, the people will come. And the Orioles are now winning, and all those stupid excuses have gone away.
Yeah. I just feel like they're... I don't know. I mean, they're next to last in all of baseball. I mean, the White Sox have more fans. The only team that's worse in attendance is Oakland. Miami averages 13,000 fans per game.
I would say if they win, that'll increase.
Yeah.
Some good marketing and winning baseball, and you'll be fine.
Maybe. By the way, the Nats are 22nd in base, about 25,000 fans.
Maybe if you stick that stupid statue back out in center field, people will come back to see that. Because I much prefer that in the stadium rather than out of the stadium. Did you take your picture in front of it?
In front of what?
The stupid statue that used to be in center field. And when the Marlins would hit a home run, the Marlin would jump over the sun. You don't remember that thing?
Oh, yeah, I remember that thing. I forgot that thing was
there. Yeah, apparently it's stationed like outside the stadium now.
Oh, I didn't notice it. They do have a kind of cool, like you go in through one gate, and then they have this cool kind of courtyard area. And I guess they do concerts and stuff because there was a stage set up, but there was nothing going on. We were there.
Right.
And then you have to get in the stadium from there.
Okay. No, I think it's winning. I think winning baseball is what you need.
All right. We just said, by the way, a quick attendance check. The Orioles' attendance this year, 28,197 per game so far this year.
The biggest growth in baseball as far as percentage of number of people that you did not have last year that you had this year.
Right, because last year was 23,000. And I think that number will just go up. And by the way, before that, it was 17,000. So we've been on a straight trajectory up in terms of attendance.
Right. So don't worry if left field's not full. We're going in the right direction with attendance.
Yeah, because we're winning. And I think the playoff games will be well attended.
I'm sure they will be sold out.
They announced schedules. Did you immediately look at your calendar to see, is this going to work out for you?
So I looked at...
I'm trying to keep the whole month of October clear. It's just getting tricky.
Yeah, so I have a big live event for the Michael Mayer Show out in Las Vegas that I purposely scheduled for November 9th because I looked at the calendar to see when the World Series would be over.
Yeah, it'd be over by then, yeah.
Because I said I can't do anything in October, just in case. I said, it sounds silly, but I have to be there if there's ever a chance.
Yeah. I have one conference October 24th, and I'm like, I didn't even put an application to present the conference. I'm going to go if the Orioles aren't playing, but I'm keeping that weekend open.
In case you're sick. Oh, sorry, I'm sick. I won't be able to attend.
Yeah. So I haven't paid my fee yet for it.
Yeah. Can I tell you about Birdland Sports real quick?
Yeah, go ahead.
I got a nice cease and desist this week.
Haven't you gotten this before? Is it the first time?
No. I got one years ago from Major League Baseball.
Yeah.
And Major League Baseball sat down with me and went through the designs and said, oh, no, we love what you're doing. We just need you to avoid this couple trademarks. I said, no problem. Right. And they blessed all the rest of my shirts. Really good. It's been great.
And you took down some? Yeah, and kept the rest. Sure.
This entire time, I have been emailing. Since before this happened, I've been emailing about once a month to the MLB Players Association.
Right.
Because I want to pay them to allow me to put the little patch on my shirts to say that the players approve.
Right. Like other t-shirt companies have done. Yeah. Sure.
So that when I come out with my James McCann shirt, it's not competing against another one that's the official one or whatever crap. And because I want to get Birdland, I think my designs are pretty cool and I want to get them inside of the warehouse. And in order to do that, I need the player's approval.
Right.
So I've been emailing them for months. I got a cease and desist from the MLB Players Association.
The same ones you've been emailing?
Same ones I've been emailing for over a year now.
Yeah.
2 years. Emailing them constantly. No response. I get one from their lawyers saying to take down the James McCann shirt. Mm. And all I can think is that a competitor turned me in.
Yeah.
Because it's been going, and we both put out McCann shirts immediately. So I take it down.
And the competitor is MLB PA approved?
Correct.
Yeah.
So I take it down and email them and say, all right, I took it down. I took down a bunch of others. I took down anything that had the player's name on it. Took down. I said, now that we know each other, I've been trying to email you for months or years. So that I can pay you.
I will take it down once you respond to my emails.
Right. So I send this email. And now it's been like 6 days. It's a zero response.
Yeah.
Because I don't know how this works. I'm ready to pay them thousands of dollars.
Yeah.
If they will just
respond. Do you know anyone else in the t-shirt business who you could ask that's not maybe a competitor?
I do not.
Give you good advice?
I can.
Yeah.
So I've got shirts up. For instance, I took down my Kobe Mayo shirt, and I scribbled off where it says Kobe Mayo.
So you can't have any names on there.
And now there's just a shirt that is a jar of mayonnaise hitting a baseball. And I took down
can guess who that might be. Yeah.
Right. I took down the James McCann shirt, and now I just have a shirt that has a catcher with a bloody nose.
Could be any catcher.
Could be any with a bloody catcher. Nose. Yeah. Could be any catcher. So just thought I'd share that I'm irritated with the Players Association because they just won't respond to my emails.
Yeah. All right. Well, if they listen to the show, please respond to your email.
Yeah. Or if anyone else can help me out, because I want to make this a legit thing. And I haven't put a whole lot of focus into it the past few months because of my new job. And of course, right when I put out like 5 new shirts, I get contacted.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, no, it's certainly a competitor.
I
snitched. It's not MLBPA checking your.
They're not searching for James McCann shirts.
Yeah.
Correct. It's the competitor.
Yeah.
And at one point.
The nasty business, that t-shirt business for these competitors. The nasty business. You got copycats. You got people snitching.
So.
All right.
I'd even be open to just selling all my designs to the competitor if that's what it took to get these designs into the stores.
Yeah.
I don't care at this point.
Yeah. All right. Well, yeah, someone help Josh out. In the meantime, I don't think anyone's going to send a cease and desist on us, right?
I don't know what for.
Well, I have referred to your opinions before as baseless. We might be getting a little email from Bird's Eye View lawyers. So look forward to that one.
I hope so. Considering, guess who told them to do segments?
Ooh, shots fired. All right, boys and girls. Thanks for listening to another episode of Section 36. Go on to iTunes or Apple Podcasts, Spotify, wherever you listen, and give us a good 5 stars. Write a review. It helps other people hear about the show. Tell your friends as we get kind of into this month of August and this playoff push. And you need some more baseball in your ears, tell your friends to listen to the Section 36 podcast. Appreciate it.
Share this video on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, whatever you do. Just spread the word.
Yeah. Helps the show. We appreciate it. All right. And that's it, right?
That's it.
You can follow us on X. Of course, you can follow me on X at Section 336. You can follow Josh on X.
At Josh Soroka. And I've been playing on TikTok. Josh Soroka 336.
And follow Birdland Sports while it still exists, right?
Follow Birdland Sports on everything.
All right, boys and girls, thanks for listening. And as always, go O's.
I'm not impressed with it.